morning. You'll stand. Here we go.
Ooh, I've been stacking up the years. I've been trading punches with the enemy. Ooh, build myself a double stick stone tower, lies higher than the eye can see. Trapped in my flesh and bone, crying out to you, Lord, I'm desperate. Oh, come rattle this cage and set me free. All of my fears like Jericho walls are gonna come down, come down. All of my fears like Jericho walls are gonna come down, come down. Oh, Lord, my prison turns to ruin.
Flesh and bone, the wounds that have set my soul forgiven. Oh, now I feel the darkness tremble there.
All of my fears like Jericho walls gonna come down, come down.
Good morning. How's everybody?
Great.
I don't know about you, but I can't think of a better way to start a Sunday morning.
Amen. Amen.
So this is Brennan. Brennan came in and talked to me about a week and a half or so ago, and we had a conversation, and he said, you know, I want to give my life to Christ. So I'm going to take his confession. I believe. That Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I accept him.
And I accept him.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
Doesn't get any better than that. Make sure if you get a chance to stick around, shake hands with him, get to know him. He's going to need your prayers because somebody's not happy today, and that's Satan. And we got a love on him like never before. So shake a hand and give him a hug or a socially distanced fist pump or whatever you do.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. To lift you up.
gates of glory moving wide. If your Lord's in, break the gate, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory
full house. Look at this. Huh? We go down to one service and everybody comes out to see me. I don't know. I think they're here to see you, Joe. That's right. Amen. No, we're going to get to that in a little bit. Some of you know Joe Kraft and Rick Swearingen, both are taking different ministry roles. But we're going to, I hope you'll stick around at the end of the service. We're going to take time to pray with both of them and their families at the end of the service. But boy, was that worship awesome? That was great, was not? That's what I was, if you're wondering what I said to Rick over here, I said, oh, I see how it is. You're going to go out like that, right? So I think that's great. But it is great to see everyone. It's great to see everyone who is joining us online this morning. For the past couple of weeks, we've been sharing some dark horse stories in the Bible, and we've learned over the last month that God always does his greatest work through the most unlikely of people. Today, our dark horse story is about a guy, a big boat, and a lot of water. I wonder if you guys know who I'm talking about. His name is Noah, and Noah's story is the answer to a compelling question. It's a question I believe some of us have probably asked ourselves a time or two. What do you do when you sense God asking you to do something that doesn't make sense? Right? What do you do? Well, the answer is you trust. You trust God when it doesn't make sense. You take a crazy step of faith. And as we jump into Noah's story, let me just say, I've been praying today. I've been praying really all week, not just today, but this morning and all, that many of you in here will think about taking a crazy step of faith today. Even if you didn't plan to do it before you came, I'm hoping that you'll express your faith in Jesus Christ as your leader and your forgiver, that you'll go public with your relationship with Jesus, just as Brennan did a few moments ago. Wouldn't that be amazing? I was thinking about this. You hear these stories of churches, you know, and they line people up and have these baptisms. I was lucky enough in India one time to be a part of that and watch like 50, 60 people get baptized. And I kept thinking, wouldn't that be amazing if we just had a huge group of people spontaneously take a crazy step of faith and give their life to Christ this morning? Now, Noah's dark horse story is told to us in Genesis chapters 6, 7, and 8. Now, a little context before that. A few chapters earlier, we read about how God created man and woman to walk with him, to enjoy this close, intimate relationship with him. He instilled within them the free will to love him, and he loved them because, let's be honest, love without freedom to choose really isn't love. And everything was rolling along fantastically, and then what happened? We all know this story, or most of us know this story. Adam and Eve chose to use their freedom to disobey God, right? They disobeyed God, and that began this free fall into some dark and some destructive behavior that absolutely broke God's heart. And by the time you get to Genesis chapter 6, what we see is archaeologists estimate that there was around 1 million people in the world at that time. So a lot smaller than what we are now, right? But what this means is that Noah was literally one in a million. Talk about a dark horse. Now take a look at our scripture. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 6 to start, starting in verse 5. It will be on the screen behind me, or you can join with your Bible or your phones or tablets or whatever. It says, "The Lord observed the extent of human wickedness on the earth, and he saw that everything they thought or imagined was consistently and totally evil. So the Lord was sorry he had ever made them and put them on the earth. It broke his heart. And the Lord said, I will wipe this human race I have created from the face of the earth." Now, question. As a parent, I want to ask, if you're a parent, how many of your parents, raise your hand if you're a parent. I want to ask you this question. Does it break your heart when your kids disobey you? Raise your hand if it breaks your heart. Right? So most of it breaks our heart, right, when kids disobey you. But what happens after that? How many of you get angry? I get angry. Anybody get angry? You get angry, right? But when kids break your heart, right, or break the rules, what happens? Usually you follow it up with some kind of punishment or some kind of repercussions, right? It makes their life tough. And as a parent, there's nothing worse than seeing rebellion in your kids. Amen? Right? So just like a parent with a rebellious child, God in this moment is watching as his people that he created, that he loved, chose to just walk away. And did you notice? It broke his heart. Look at our main text, verse 8. But Noah, now what you got? I got to stop there just for a minute because this is this transitional phrase, and I love this about the Bible. Throughout scripture, there's these transitional phrases, and thank goodness that there is, right? But it says, but Noah found favor with the Lord. Notice the word favor. That phrase literally means that an extraordinary person is giving an ordinary person, a dark horse person, a second chance, right? In other words, God was giving Noah and his family a gracious opportunity to not be wiped off of the face of the earth after the destruction, right? So Noah was one in a million. Now, Noah was a guy in a line of godly guys. His dad was a man named Lamech. His grandfather was the oldest living man in history. His name is Methuselah. He lived to be 969 years of age. Anybody want to do that? 969 years old. And his great-granddad was a guy named Enoch, who simply is described in the Bible as someone who walked with God, right? And that's how Noah is described. Genesis 6, verse 9. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, a blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. Now, let's stop there and think about this for a minute, because I thought it would be really cool. Wouldn't you love to be that person? Like when people saw you on the street and they'd say, boy, I know him, he walks with God. Or I know her, she walks with God. Wouldn't that be neat? Yes? Yes? That'd be cool, wouldn't it? You at home, that would be awesome to be known as a person who walks with God. Now, what you need to know here, though, is Noah, it says he's blameless. That doesn't mean he was perfect, okay? Doesn't mean that he was without sin. No one is. But what it means is he tried to walk with God. He got up every day trying to be more and more like God. And again, with Noah's story, we learned the answer to a very compelling question. What do you do when you sense God asking you to take a step that looks crazy, not only to others, but also to you, right? You obey God even when you don't understand it. That's what you do. Now, I know this sounds weird, but at this point in time, Noah is about 500 years old. So I'm guessing maybe he was going through a midlife crisis, okay? You know, he's got maybe 400 and some years left if he lives as old as Methuselah. You know, he didn't, but you know. So he's about 500 years old. He's probably going through this midlife crisis at this time. And what we see here is in Genesis 6, we hear this whole deal. Here's what God comes to him and says. He says, I want you to build a boat to save you and your family because it's going to flood. Now, from a human perspective, this is really ludicrous, right? Noah lives at least 500 miles from the nearest body of water. So just think about that. God comes to you and says, I want you to build a boat, but you're 500 miles from the nearest body of water, which at that time would have been the Mediterranean Sea. How is he going to get the boat there? I mean, it wasn't like he was going to build this boat, call a semi, and have a flatbed come pick it up, load it up, and take it, right? I mean, that wasn't going to happen. It's just not going to happen. But see, when you understand the essence of faith, God's commission to Noah starts to make sense. Look at Hebrews, going into the New Testament, chapter 11, verse 1. We read, now faith is confidence in what we hope for, and it's assurance about what we do not see. Now, here's the struggle for us as humans. We tend to struggle with, we hear it, but you've heard me say before, we also what? We want to see it, right? You've heard me say this from stage before. We want to see that next step. We want to see what God has in store for us instead of just listening to it and trusting. So if God had commissioned me to build an ark, I'd be wanting to confirm it. Anybody else? I mean, if you were Noah, you'd want to confirm it. Like I would be, here's what I'd be doing. Alexa, is it going to rain? You know? Hey, Alexa, how far is it to the nearest beach? Like, you know, how's this going to happen? And to add to all of this, one very important piece of information that we don't want to miss is Noah had never seen it rain before. He'd never seen it rain before. Because in Genesis 2 actually indicates the way the earth was watered in the early days was through a mist that kind of came up from the caverns in the ground. Now, when you read about that, I'm thinking, boy, that'd be like a spa, wouldn't it? You know, just go in and sit down and just, you know, I don't know. I guess I'm the only one that likes spas. It's the second Sunday in a row I've talked about spas. But it just kind of reminds me of that, you know. So it was kind of like a dew in the morning that would appear. And the whole atmosphere and ecosystem were different because it had never rained. Some scientists actually believe this is why people live longer in those days. All right, so God gave some specific instructions to Noah. I came prepared today. Hope you guys are okay with me preaching today. God gave specific instructions to Noah to build a boat, a really big boat, commonly known as the Ark, which translates, means palace, which, you know, I don't know, that's kind of funny. I don't know. It's a big palace on water, right? And God gave him a materialist. The boat was to be made of gopher wood, okay? And it was supposed to be sealed with tar on the inside and tar on the outside. Scholars would maybe say that the gopher wood was like pine or cedar, okay? And then it was to be 450 feet long, which is about a football field and a half, 75 feet wide, about the width of a six-lane superhighway, 45 feet tall, about four-and-a-half-story building with bottom, middle, and upper decks. Now, you can do the math here. It is a massive floating palace, the equivalent of 522 railroad boxcars. That's how big it is. The ark could have carried in excess 125,000 sheep. So just think of that alone. Who wants to clean that up in the middle of the day, right? I mean, it's a big boat that's going to carry a lot of things. So here's a picture of the ark. I took this. Now, this isn't the actual ark, so just so you know that. But you can go to Kentucky and visit this. I would encourage you to go if you've never been. My wife and I went with some friends from North Carolina to see it. And that just gives you an idea. And they've really did some work on the inside and everything. Now I'm going to tell you, it's not tar on the outside. I've never seen so many rivets on the outside of my life. I think Noah would have really liked that. But it gives you an idea. Because think about how big that is, and he's going to build that in the middle of a desert, right? Middle of a desert. And God says, I want you to build this boat, and then I want you and your family to get in the boat with two of every kind of living animal, and then I'm going to cleanse the world of its violence and corruption and depravity and sin with a flood, and I'm going to start over. That's how he says it. It all seems crazy, right? It seems ludicrous, but that's exactly what Noah does. Even though it didn't make any sense. And it's a reminder to all of us, what's crazy in one season will be counted as faith in another. Sometimes just having the courage to obey God, as crazy as it seems, is the turning point for living a life of faithfulness. And again, I'm praying, I really am, all week, that some of you in here will stop making excuses and you'll go public with your faith today. Through baptism in Jesus, accepting him as Lord and Savior, because the word faith and the word obey always are connected in the word of God. Look at what scripture says again in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. It was by faith that Noah built an ark to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about something that had never happened before. Again, notice the word faith and the word obey, because they go together, right? Imagine this. What if God came to you one day and he says, you know what? I don't like how the world's going. I really don't. I don't like this, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to flood the world. We're going to start all over, and I picked your family to start with. We're going with your family, okay? You're the ones. So you build this ship, right? And if you build this ship, you do what I tell you. I'm going to bring in all the animals, okay? We'll take care of that. Would you believe that? How many of you would believe it? I don't see a hand, right? Some of you have seen, what is it, Evan Almighty or whatever? Some of you have seen that, right? Do you think you would have some doubts, some questions? Who would have doubts and questions? We'd have doubts and questions, right? But Noah doesn't doubt. Well, this is important. He doesn't doubt. He doesn't complain. He doesn't argue. He doesn't delay. He gets his boys. He goes down to Menards with a materialist. He loads up the truck, and he heads out, and he starts to build, right? Even though it doesn't make sense. So let me ask you this question. Do you have the guts and the grit and the faith to obey God even when you don't understand it? What about when God says, you know that personal enemy over there that hurt you? That person who stabbed you in the back, who betrayed you? Well, I want you to love them. I want you to pray for her. I want you to forgive them. That doesn't make sense to us, does it? Or what if you're a single person and God says, you know what, I don't want you to marry that person who doesn't share your spiritual convictions. I want you to actually be able to share the most important part of your life with the most important person in your life, right? What about when God says, if you sincerely put your faith in Jesus Christ, my son who died for you on a cross and rose from the dead, I want you to take the first step in obeying me by accepting me as Lord and Savior and following through with Christian baptism. Noah obeys God even though it doesn't make sense. And then guess how long he waits? Guess how long he waits for all this to unfold? Anybody? It's on the screen, right? 120 years. 120 years that he waits around. Think about that. Now, I don't know about you, but if I was Noah around year 75, okay, of building the ark and no rain going on around me, I'd be having a few doubts. Wouldn't you? Anybody? Am I the only person here? I'd be having some doubts here about whether this was really going to happen or not. And how, you know, I'll bet there were days that he just wanted to say, you know what? I don't want to build the ark anymore. I'm done. I'm tired, right? I need a break. I've worked on this thing for 75 years. I'm headed down to Culver's. I'm getting a double Butterburger basket and some custard. I'm taking it easy. I'm finished. I don't want anything to do with this. I'm curious, though. Have you learned, as Noah needed to learn, that God's timing is always different than our timing? Because we want things now, don't we? We want them right now. I know this, after 27 years of marriage, I've learned when Heather says she'll be ready in 10 minutes, her time and my time are different, folks. I don't know about you. Any men out there want to amen that? No, you guys want to sleep in your house tonight, don't you? Noah waited for 120 years. I love what Philip Yancey writes about Noah. He says, faith means trusting in advance what will only make sense in reverse. I would imagine that Noah had his doubts, his share of sleepless nights, maybe even popped a few Tums a time to time. But by faith, Noah obeyed God. Even when God had warned him about things that had never happened before and that he didn't understand. Second thing you would do, you ignore detractors and keep moving forward. You know, frequently when you walk by faith and obey God, other people think you're kind of nutty. Anybody ever experienced that? Right? I mean, can you imagine the ridicule Noah took for 120 years building a boat? And not just a little boat, right? We're talking about a palace, right? The three times the size of the Statue of Liberty, and there's not a cloud in the sky, and he lives in the middle of the desert. I mean, think about what he's doing. And how about his three sons? He had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Jephthah, helping their dad, right? Hammering and sawing away, helping him do all this work. Do you think they maybe ever once in a while looked at each other and said, I think dad's losing it, right? I mean, he's 500 years old. He's in a midlife crisis. He's blowing all of our inheritance on a cruise ship, right? Could be dementia. Maybe we need to get him checked out, right? I mean, they had to have some doubt here. Now, friends, if you want to live a dark horse kind of life, spiritually speaking, be prepared. Listen to me, church. Be prepared to be criticized and misunderstood and even considered crazy. Because, listen, you're going to feel led by God to do some things that lots of people aren't going to understand. It's just going to happen, and you got to be prepared. I'll give you an example. It might not be a very good example, but the first time I decided to go to India, people thought I was crazy. Why would you want to go to India? And when I came home and I talked about it, and I decided 4 years later, that's after I had arrived here 4 years later, that I was going to go back. Even the people that knew I went before and stuff were asking me, really, why do you want to go? That's really crazy, right? Why don't you go to the beach? You know, I mean, go there for a few weeks. It's cheaper, it's safer, it's cleaner, it's more relaxing. I mean, makes sense, right? Do you want to know my answer? Here's my answer. People who think I'm crazy have never experienced a worship service in the middle of a field in 130 degree weather with 3,000 high school students praising, singing, and dancing and worshiping Jesus. They've never seen that. They've never experienced walking up to widows who are thought of by the government as nothing but trash and handing them a bag of rice that's going to feed their family for a month and giving them a piece of clothing. They've never experienced that. Okay? They've never experienced walking into an orphanage where these kids, they have been abandoned. Some of the stories, some of these kids were abandoned in trash heaps and trash dumps. That's where they were found. And when you walk in, anybody walks in, they just light up, right? They just smile at you. It just fills the room, right? And they've never experienced that. They've never witnessed it. And I could go on and on and on and tell you exactly why I'm okay with people calling me crazy. I wonder how many of you have been called crazy because you tithe 10% of your income to Union Christian Church. Some of you in here go above and beyond that. And I'm sure you've been called crazy, especially if you're open about it and talked about it. We have a great group of volunteers at UCC, amen? They love this church. They head to UCC every Sunday, every weekend. They work in the children's ministry. They work in the student ministry. They work in the production teams, the worship teams, the connect teams, the new coffee team. I mean, they come here and they work. And neighbors just can't understand why these volunteers give up one day a week to go serve at their church or go be at their church, right? They can't understand why would you do that when you could be playing golf or when you could be in your pool or when you could take the boat out or when you could have slept in, right? Because you don't get to sleep in very often. Or you could have done a million other things. Why would you go to church? Why would you do that and serve? Who would do that? I tell you who would do that. Someone who knows the promises of God. That's who. I mean, they don't understand what it's like for some of you to hold a newborn baby in your hands, right? And you hold that newborn baby for the first time, just as this new couple started coming to church and they're trying the church out for the very first time. You know, maybe they haven't been ever, maybe they haven't been in a long time, and you're holding their new baby in the nursery, and what you're doing the entire time you're in there is you're praying for this child's family. Because they're here in the church, and you're hoping that somewhere in the middle of God's presence, in the middle of worship, in the middle of the sermon, that something in this message will touch them, that their experience will be amazing, that there will be a moment of transformation. Some of you go on vacation. I don't know how many of you, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but some of you go on vacation, you watch Union Christian Church online, or you watch another church online, right? And why would you do that, right? Why would you sit in your hotel room down at the beach and watch church online? Why would you do it? The average person in America would look at you and say, you're out of your mind, right? Wouldn't they? They would say, why are you watching Union Christian Church online when there's a beach just out this way or when, you know, the lazy river is sitting right there that you can get in, or if you like the mountains, you know, the mountains are right there. And we don't have any of that in Indiana, right? I don't see it, but, you know, why would you do that? People would tell you, you're crazy. You're crazy because you do that. And maybe some of you are thinking about giving your life to Jesus today. And being baptized. Maybe you watch Brennan do that and you think, you know what, I've been putting this off a long time. Maybe today's the day, right? But you worry. You know why you worry? You worry because you wonder what your family's going to think. You wonder what your friends at work are going to think. You wonder what the kids at school are going to think. You wonder about all that because, let's just be honest, in 2021, it's not very acceptable to follow Jesus Christ. It's not acceptable to say you're a follower of Jesus in 2021. But dark horse type people, Noah type people, they ignore detractors and they keep moving forward. They keep moving forward. And this is one of the reasons I believe God has blessed UCC and continues to bless our church. Last year, during a worldwide pandemic, this church remained faithful in their giving. And we were blessed, I mean, blessed beyond blessed, right? To be able to purchase some much needed online equipment. We were able to step out in faith and help families in the community that needed help. In a time where the leadership, right? We were having conversation, the leadership and staff, and we were having doubts about, you know, what our income was going to look like. And if we were going to be forced to lay off staff or stop certain ministries or whatever was going to happen. And all of you in here were faithful and stayed the course. And some of you went above and beyond. And we don't come back and report it. We finished at 99.6% of our budget last year during a world pandemic. And I know churches that had to lay off staff. I know churches that had to stop certain ministries because of that. And I also know of other churches that were blessed just like we were blessed through a pandemic. Now, I don't know about you, but that could classify, right, some of you as crazy in the eyes of your neighbors or your coworkers or the people you go to school with. What do you do when you sense God asking you to take a step that looks crazy? Dark horses obey God even when you don't understand it and ignore detractors that keep moving forward. And finally, you maximize opportunities while the doors are still open. You see, God gives each of us strategic opportunities in our lifetime to walk with him, to follow him, to go on an adventure of faith with him. But listen, those open doors, they don't last forever. The doors won't be open forever. After 120 years of building this boat, after going through all the ridicule and all the doubts and the questions and the waiting, I want you to look at what Genesis chapter 7, verse 1 says. It says this, it says, when everything was ready, the Lord said to Noah, go into the boat with all your family. The word translated go there in the Hebrew is actually the word come. Noah means rest. Jesus is saying, come and I will give you rest, right? I love that, right? The door to the ark is open. The door to safety is open. And God gives this personal invitation and he says, come. Church is equal to the ark, right? It's a safe place for us to come and to rest. And I especially like how God says, come into the ark, you and your whole family. In the New Testament, we often see entire families come and follow Jesus. If you go over to the book of Acts, chapter 16, we read about the Philippian jailer. He believed, and all the others in his household, they also believed. And then immediately after that, him and his family were all baptized in Christ. Often around UCC, we have seen this, right? There's been times that I've had the opportunity to baptize a husband and wife or a group of friends some parents and their kids or whatever. I've seen this, whether it happened on the same day or it happened over a month or so. And it's just amazing to me, I don't know about you, but how God works that out. And we get to see that and we get to see people come to the kingdom. I love it. It's really, really cool. And God says, come. And Noah and his entire family walked through the door while the door was still open. The word come is actually used around 1,100 times in just the Old Testament, just so you know that. And then if you go over to Revelation, just for an example, Jesus said in Revelation, whoever is thirsty, let him walk. Let him come. Let him come. Now, that gracious invitation from God had been to the whole world for 120 years. 120 years, this invitation has been out there. And while Noah built the ark, he pleaded with them because Noah understood the stakes and what this would mean for his neighbors. But here's the sad thing, and you got to get this, okay? Because for 120 years, not one person responded. Not one. And I've often wondered what it would be like to preach for so many years and never have anyone ever respond to the message. But you're not telling me that Noah wasn't preaching the gospel while he was building that ark. And not one single person gave their life. And then miraculously, God did what? He brought the animals in two by two. Two by two, here they come. They load everything up. And finally, all the animals and Noah's family get on the boat. And the door closes. And guess what happens? It doesn't rain the first day, it doesn't rain the second day, it doesn't rain the third day, it doesn't rain the fourth day, it doesn't rain the fifth day, it doesn't even rain the sixth day, right? And everybody's still laughing. Can you see them? I can see them, all standing outside the boat, right? All partying, all having a great time, all laughing it up, all thinking it's a big joke, right? Everybody's laughing at Noah. Noah the fool, right? His whole family's a fool, but the sixth night, people notice something they've never noticed. The sky gets darker. The wind is rising. And at midnight, the thunder and lightning and the rain begins. And we're not talking about drops. We're not talking showers. Have you ever been in that one where it's sideways? It's sheets of rain. Anybody been there? Seen that? We're talking sheets of rain. And before morning, it's ankle high. The next day, it's knee high. The following day, it's waist high. And they see the ark starting to float. Can you imagine that? In the middle of a desert. It just starts to raise up. It's starting to float, right? But the door of opportunity is now shut. And for 40 days and nights, it rains, it pours, and the water consumes the earth. And when it's finished, the world is strangely silent. They had 120 years to walk through the open door and turn towards God's direction. But one day, the door closed, and they missed their opportunity. I've often wondered to myself, I don't know if anybody else has, but I've often wondered if Noah was here, if there's a way to bring him up on stage and ask him what was happening in that moment, what that was like, what would he say? And I got to believe that Noah would talk about the rawness of it all, the devastation of it all, and the fact that real people died, friends and relatives and neighbors died because they didn't come through the open door when they had the opportunity. Now, before I go any further, I want to make sure everybody is on the same page here. That was in the Old Testament. Today, the door is open to all of you. It's wide open. And you have pastors like me and leaders in churches that are preaching the gospel and asking you to confess Christ and give your life to Jesus. And you just keep putting it off and putting it off and putting it off and putting it off. And if you noticed in Noah's story, what happened? The door finally closed. The opportunity was gone. And so many think that opportunity won't disappear. It will disappear one day. It will come to an end one day. Actually, Jesus talks about this in the New Testament. Jesus uses the story of Noah as a warning for the day when he returns in Luke chapter 17. It says in verse 26, when the Son of Man returns, it will be like it was in Noah's day. In those days, the people enjoyed banquets and parties and weddings right up to the time that Noah entered his boat and the flood came and destroyed them all. Sometimes you can wait too long, church. Sometimes doors close much quicker than what you think. And I really believe that God is looking for people today who will walk through the door of grace while it's open. I believe God is looking for some Noahs who will obey him, even though you don't totally understand it all right now. And who in here will ignore the detractors and keep moving forward and maximize the opportunities while the doors are still open? And for some of you, that door of opportunity is to put your faith in Jesus Christ and turn from your past and your sins and turn in his direction. And by faith, ask him to be your leader and your forgiver. It's not that difficult. But I will tell you, it's the absolute best decision you'll ever make in your life. There is no better decision ever. I don't care about who you're going to marry or how many kids you're going to have or where you're going to go to school or what you're going to do for the next 30 or 40 years or where you're going to retire or none of that. Giving your life to Jesus is the most important decision that you can make in your entire life. But so many of us put it on hold. For many of you, the door of opportunity is to step out, fall, or confess him, be baptized today while the doors are open. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 20 and 21 compares baptism to Noah's flood. And it says, God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. Okay? I love this because guess what? He's been waiting patiently for a lot of us. It goes on to say, in it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved. Think of that. There was 1 million people on earth at that time, and eight people were saved. Eight people were saved. That's it. And there was 1 million people there. They were saved through water, and this water symbolizes baptism and now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. So what saves you, church? What saves you? I tell you what saves you. The resurrection of Jesus Christ saves you. The resurrection of Jesus Christ saves you, and then you confessing him as Lord and Savior, as Brennan did just earlier, and making that promise that you're going to follow him, making that promise that you're going to try to be like Jesus every day, and then following in Christian baptism, that's what sets you right. Noah and his family were actually saved by the floodwaters because the floodwaters lifted the ark up, and that's how their lives were spared. And baptism symbolizes the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus that is now available to each and every one of us. And my question for you, how important is that to you? How important is it to you? What's to prevent you from taking that step and being baptized today? Why wouldn't you say yes to Jesus and yes to baptism while the door is open? Why wouldn't you? Well, you might come to me and say, you know what? I couldn't be baptized today. Well, why couldn't you be baptized? And you might say, well, I haven't had a baptism class. I just gave you one. Well, I came as a guest with some friends, and I don't want to inconvenience them. Let me tell you, if you're a guest here, this church will celebrate with you. I guarantee it. Or you might think, but I look so good today, right? Like I spent all this time getting ready. Look at this. I wore a sport coat. I got my Kohans on. Man, I'm looking good, right? I'll do it another time. That's your pride getting in the way, and you just need to get rid of that. But I wasn't planning on this today. Well, you may have not had it written on your calendar, but I'm telling you, God has it circled on his calendar. You may have not come prepared, but we have everything you need. We have towels, don't we, Brennan? We have towels, and he brought his own swim trunks, but we have gowns that you can put on, and we have everything you need to make it happen today. You say, well, what about my stuff? You know, what about my wallet or my purse or my iPhone or you know, I carry a Google Pixel or whatever, but, you know, what about my stuff? You know, what about it? Hey, we have some really trustworthy security guys here. They'll take care of your stuff. They'll watch it. They'll make sure it's okay, right? Or you might say, well, I'm just visiting and I don't know that I want to become a member yet. You know, I'm just not sure about your church. Hey, that's fine. Listen, we're not sure about you either, so... The important thing is, listen, we're not baptizing you into a church. We're baptizing you in the name of Jesus Christ. Maybe you say, well, I want a family member or a friend to be here. I mean, everybody likes that. I mean, look, Brennan's got his family here with him, right? Everybody likes that. Well, I don't know if you know this. All this is on live right now. So if your family member misses out on this, we'll be glad to show them. And just so you know, your family is here. Jesus is here. Your Heavenly Father is looking down like he did when Jesus was baptized himself. And when you come up out of that water, just as Brennan came up out of that water, he will look at you and he will say, this is my son, this is my daughter that I love, who I am well pleased. In a moment, Rick and Lisa, they're going to come out and they're going to sing the song, The Blessing. It's a beautiful song. And my prayer is that as they sing, many of you, I know some of you are like, wait a minute, is he really doing that? I am. My prayer is that you'll come and you'll meet me down here and you'll give your life to Christ. That you'll finally make that commitment because the door's open and it's only going to be open for so long and then it's going to shut. And yeah, you're right. It could be considered a crazy step of faith. But I'm asking you, ignore the detractors and maximize the opportunity because listen, church, the door will not always be open. And you might think, well, I can do this next week, right? Do you know that? Can you guarantee that? Do you know that you have 100% chance to do that next week? There's no good reason for you to leave here today without hope because Jesus, listen to me, Jesus is your living hope. There's no good reason for you to leave here today defeated because Jesus offers you victory. There's no good reason for you to leave without the assurance of salvation because Jesus died, he was buried, and he rose for you. And I'm hoping that some of you men here, right? Some of you men may lead your families because listen to me, church, men, real men, they follow God. They follow Jesus. They put their trust in him. Maybe some entire families or friends or couples will make the decision. I don't know. And church, I'm praying that we are here for I don't care how long. I don't have anything better to do today. I don't know about you, but I can't think of anything better than seeing a child of God finally come home. If you're with us here online, there's a way that you can make a step of faith. I know some of you at home might be excited. Maybe you want to make a step of faith, and I would ask that you send an email to the email address. It'll be behind me on the screen, and they'll put us in contact with you immediately. Church, Noah took a crazy step of faith. He obeyed God.
even when it didn't make sense. He ignored everyone around him. And that had to be hard for 120 years to ignore that, but he ignored it. And because he did that, his family was saved. I often think about how hard it is for my kids. I have a 24-year-old, a 22-year-old, and a 20-year-old, and how hard it is to claim Jesus in 2021. There's often times that I pray for a lot of our college students and our high school students, our middle school students, because I've heard the stories and I know the arguments they're having, and I know the things they're going through, and being told that it's crazy, right? It's crazy for you to follow Jesus. It's crazy for you to get up on a Sunday morning and come here. And some of you adults in here have shared your stories with me that it's crazy, right? That you do those things. But for those of you that have given your life to Jesus, you followed through, you've accepted him, you've been baptized, you know it's worth it. Amen? There's nothing else worth it. And if you're in here and you have not made that decision, and if it seems like I'm begging, okay? Because I don't want anyone to pass away and not know Jesus. My dying wish is that as many people as I can tell Jesus about comes to know him. And not for me, not for my glory, not for a pat on the back on mine, but for God. It's all for God's glory, amen? If you have a decision to make, I don't care how crazy it might seem to you, I ask that you come meet me down here. I ask that you come confess as we listen to this song, as we remember the sacrifice that Christ made on the cross for us. Take time to listen to these words. It's a beautiful, beautiful song. Let's pray. Father God, we love you. And Father, we thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you for all that you are. Father, I thank you for the Dark Horse series, Father, as we've seen extraordinary people be used by you. They weren't extraordinary before you got to them, but by the end they became extraordinary people that we read about, that we learn from. And Father, there are dark horses in this room that I know you will call and you will use to make a difference for the kingdom. Father, my heart is heavy for those who don't know you. I pray that if there's someone in here who needs to make a decision and follow through, that they just come. It isn't that hard. That they just come and they confess you as Lord and Savior. Father, we love you. Father, we pray this in your name. Amen. Amen.
children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning and the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you.
Worship. The band I know has another song or whatever, but we've had a young lady and a gentleman come down front who want to give their life to Christ today and say yes to Jesus. So hopefully all of you will stick around for that. And I'm sure MCL or whatever will still be there, still waiting for you. You'll probably miss the lines, but they're going to continue in worship. I'm going to go change, and we'll see you here in just a few minutes. Zach, if when they're done, if you'll get the screen for me. Thank you all.
On yonder hill, the darkness flew. When morning broke in light and dew, when day had come again anew, all we sinners sang. In muck and mire, our wretched souls had fallen to the depths below. Thank you.
Anybody else excited or just me? So this is Jasmine, and Jasmine just walked up with tears in her eyes, and she said, it's time. I want to give my life to Jesus. So I'm going to ask her to repeat after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I accept him.
And I accept him.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
And this is Kenny. And this is proof, and I'm not making fun of Kenny's age at all, but it's proof that it doesn't matter how old you are, that you can give your life to Christ at any point in time. Amen. So Kenny, I'm going to ask you to do the same thing. Repeat after me. I believe. That Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
Son of the living God.
And I accept him.
And I accept him.
As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
Because I am not a super changer at all. At this time, I want to ask all the leaders, and the kids can stay in, Janice, if you want them to, but all the leaders to come up, please, deacons and elders on stage. And then we'd like to ask Deanna to join Rick and worship band. You can be up here with us too. Please don't go anywhere. And we're going to pray with Rick, and we're going to pray with his wife. I was doing fine until I looked at you. Rick is, we're excited. He's taken a position with Carbon Baptist to be their worship pastor. Isn't that amazing? That's awesome. So we want to pray with him and pray with his wife. Did she come up here? Yeah. I'm going to hold on to the mic. So if you guys would go stand up front, please. Yes, we're going to put you right up front, Deanna, I know. All the worship band and leaders, we're going to go on. And I'm going to ask if the congregation will stand with us as we pray. And we have, Rob and Dustin are going to pray for the Swearingens. And then don't go anywhere, because then we're going to pray for someone else and his wife also. So go ahead, guys.
Dear and Father, just what an amazing day you've created. Dear Lord, you had this mapped out. You had this planned. It's a difficult day, dear Lord, but it's an amazing day. That it's just how you work, dear Lord. You work in ways that challenge us, dear Lord, but also in ways that when we accept that call, it's just embraced in so many different ways, dear Lord. We thank you so much for the individuals that gave their life to you, dear Lord, today. And that's accepting a call, a mighty call, dear Lord, that as a congregation, not only UCC, dear Lord, but your body, we have to embrace that responsibility as well, dear Lord, to pray for them and nurture them and strengthen them, dear Lord. We also come to you right now praying for Rick and answering a call, dear Lord. And dear Father, it's always tough sometimes when we see somebody go through a brick and mortar building, dear Lord, but that's not your building. That's not your body, dear Lord. Your body extends so much further than that, dear Lord. And Rick has accepted that call and his family, dear Lord, and with Deanna. And we just pray, dear Lord, that you strengthen them and that you give them the vision and stamina, dear Lord, to go on this new journey for you, dear Lord, not for them, but for you, dear Lord. And they accepted that call, and it's so tough to do, and a lot of changes, a lot of unknowns, dear Lord. But with you, so much is possible. You've made this possible. They stepped out on their faith. They trust, dear Lord, and they had courage. So many elements that you require of us, dear Lord, that when we accept that call, so much can be attained. And we just thank you so much for them, their work, dear Lord, and what they're going to do for you. And as a body here at UCC, dear Lord, may we support that, dear Lord. It is. There's a lot of tears going to be shed, and there's going to be I won't say emptiness, dear Lord, but we're going to miss this family. We're going to miss the worship, miss that leadership, dear Lord. But may we also embrace the fact that you're being reached out, dear Lord. You're being extended through this step. And we just thank you so much for that. We thank you for Rick. We thank you for his family. And bless them, dear Lord, and continue to bless UCC.
Father, Lord, we just... As Dustin said, we ask you to bless this family. Father, my own personal desires will never trump yours. And I do not want to see them leave. But Father, your plan is mighty. You are amazing. And you've given gifts that are amazing. And Father, I've got to know Rick over the last couple of years, and Father, one of the things that I've learned is you've given him a gift. It's an amazing gift, Father. His ear, his voice, his spirit, and his desire to serve you. And Father, I pray that that gift will be seen far beyond this building as it's already been, but in a new body, Father, in another body that desires to worship you. Father, give them ears to hear and eyes to see. And Father, I pray that they don't just hear his voice or see him on stage, but Father, really what they do is they hear and see you. You are the one to be praised, Father, and it's through this family that we wish to do so. We thank you so much for this family, Lord, and we praise you for them. May your blessings continue well beyond these walls. And Father, may you be glorified in all things. It's your son's name we pray. Amen.
Everybody stand still. We're going to switch out. Jen, would you like to join us? And your whole family can come if they want. That's up to them. I know that. I know how much the girls love to be on stage. So we're going to pray with them here in just a minute. Mike's going to pray, and then I'll follow up. But I didn't really rehearse anything except this family means a lot to us. Joe was here when I got here, and we brought him on full time, and we've worked together for almost 5.5 years, and I appreciate him, and I appreciate his family, and the leaders appreciate him. We love them. We wish them the best. I think Joe's going to succeed at whatever he puts his mind to, and will do very well in this next ministry that God is calling him to, just as I believe Rick will be blessed in his ministry. As Rob said, it's sad to see people go, but man, it's amazing to see how God works and the lives that will be touched through these two men and their families in the new ministries that they're going to start. Okay, Mike.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, and we lift up Joe and Jen and their family and their children to you this morning, Father. Lord, we thank you for Joe and the gifts that you've blessed him with. They are evident, and we appreciate that so much. Father, my prayer is you're such a wonderful, mysterious God, and it's just one of the things I love about you, Lord. And I know that you're working all things for your good, regardless how you work them, Father. It's all for your own, your good and your kingdom. I pray you bless Joe. I pray, oh Holy Spirit, that you would reside in him and that the words that come out of his mouth in the weeks and the months and the years to come would be for your purpose. I pray that you would grant him the message, Father, that you need him to speak. I pray that the people that he's speaking them to would be recipients with open hearts and minds, that they might be drawn closer to you and your kingdom would flourish. I pray that you would watch over Joe and his family. Thank you so much for them, Lord. I pray you'd bless them with health and well-being and provision. Father, you bless us with what we need, and you equip us with what we need. When Joe feels unequipped, I pray, Lord, he could feel your presence in the work that he's going to be a part of. Help him to seek your kingdom and where you are working. Help him to join you, Lord, there, and bring glory and honor to your name, and that hearts and lives would be touched and changed for your purpose. Lord, you are such an awesome God. And I know that Joe loves you and he loves your son, Jesus Christ. We thank you so much for your son, Jesus Christ, and the gift that he is, that we might be joined to your side and be home again someday at your calling. We love you, Lord. We praise your name. We thank you for Joe and Jen and their family. Watch over them. Thank you so much for them. I just pray for your blessings on them as they go forward out to do your work. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. I'm going to offer a prayer before you stop, and then we'll close out. Father God, we love you, and we just thank you for the time that we've been able to gather here and the many blessings that have happened today, Father. We celebrate and rejoice with the three lives who have made a commitment to follow you. And Father, at the same time that we celebrate, we come to you with a heavy heart, Father, as we watch two brothers who are leaving, who have been called out to what some might say is crazy, but called out to take a step of faith and follow through out of their comfort zones into different ministries where they're going to be able to reach out and to so many other people, Father, in your name. Father, we have grown to call both these families just that, their family. And again, as our hearts are saddened to see them leave, we know that you will bless both of them and their wives and their families and their ministries, and that the kingdom will be blessed and will continue to grow, which is what it's all about, is to watch the kingdom grow, Father. Thank you for that. Father, we love you. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Church family, we love you. Thank you for sticking around. Say goodbye to these families, and hopefully you'll be back next week. Just because they're leaving, we're still having church. See y'all.
That's right. Come see what